Hello, I will talk about similarity between liquid crystal temperature effects and particle physics. So, for liquid crystal, let us look at second slide. There are observed experimentally many long-range interactions. So we get so-called director field. In each point there is a direction of molecule, and looking at positions of such topological defects like here. We can see that there is some acceleration, and they can get acceleration like various types of long-range interactions, including Coulomb interaction. So the question is if you can use this resemblance to get closer to particle physics. So the first thing we would like to focus on is there are two problems with electromagnetism. So one problem is that taking point charge, we have infinite energy. So the integrating electric energy of electric field down to radius zero, we get infinite energy. The second problem is that Gauss law in electromagnetism gives real charge, any real charge, but in nature we have only integer charges. So to repair both, we use these topological defects and regularize them. For example, here we use director field as a vacuum of unitary vectors. So these unitary vectors can form this hedgehog-like. So the topological defect means that going along this loop, the field rotates. It has to rotate 2 pi times some integer number. so we get quantization of this topological charge this way. And having this Higgs potential, the field can deform in the center, because otherwise, if it would have to remain unitary vectors, you would have the discontinuity, so you would have again infinite energy. So thanks of Higgs potential, we can deform the field. So the problem with this infinite energy will be resolved with the Higgs-like potential to regularize the field. And the problem with Gauss law will be resolved by making that Gauss law count topological charge. So in two dimension, we would have the integration over the change of angle here, and it would have to be 2 pi times some integer number. In three dimensions, we would like to have the real Gauss law. So we can do it by looking at this function from some closed surface in Gauss law into sphere, being then the possible these unitary vectors. So the Jacobian of this function, so to get this the number of how many times we are winding around this sphere, you have to integrate Jacobian of this function, which turns out to be the curvature like here. So interpreting this curvature as electric field, we get Gauss law which counts topological charge, so it has to have charge quantization as topological charge. So this way we repair these two problems. So one is this regularization by using Higgs-like potential, and the second is that the Gauss law cannot return any real charge, it can only return integer charges as topological charge. Here we can also see that we can have one half topological charge in 2D, because this object, this ellipsoid, after rotating by pi, brings us the same ellipsoid. So while rotating only by pi, we get kind of half of them, one half charge. So it kind of resembles spins. So we'll talk about further. So as electric charge, we would like to have this kind of configuration, this hedgehog configuration. So with liquid crystals, they realize this kind of configurations, for which we can get the Coulomb interaction. So in Lorentz invariant models, we get the entire electromagnetism. Then the idea here is to go to biaxial pneumatic. So they are more difficult experimentally, but now they are approaching to using them in laboratory. So there is a chance for this kind of three. So in biaxial pneumatic you have three distinguishable axes, and so we can have hedgehog of one of three axes, getting the same topological charge asymptotically, but with different realization, so we can a bit different regularization, so they should have different masses. So we kind of get three types of simplest charged particles like leptons. So there is some resemblance with leptons for this biaxial pneumatics. Also looking at the trying to align the second axis, there is this Heribor theorem saying that we cannot do it in continuous way. So there appear also some singularities at this surface of this sphere around. So suggesting some magnetic like singularity. So using this biaxial pneumatic, we cannot have naked charges. They also need to have this magnetic dipole, as we know from physics. So there are some nice suggestions, which should be realizable in laboratory in biaxial pneumatics in a few months maybe. Okay, so we have also. So here we have three distinguishable axes in three dimensions, but reminding that we live in 4D space-time suggests to maybe use four axes in space-time. So if using this fourth axis as having the tendency to align in parallel way, then while we get one set of Maxwell equations for electromagnetics for dynamics of this axis in space, for this fourth direction, zeroth direction, we get a second set of Maxwell equations. So second set of Maxwell equations for gravity is called gravity electromagnetics, and is used as approximation of general relativity. For example, the gravity probe beam experiment has confirmed this approximation. So we get very 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 simple unification of this service of electromagnetics in space by rotation of the first axis, the longest axis in space. Also the going from uniaxial to biaxial pneumatic, there is an additional twist around this first axis. So we start recognizing this twisting of this first axis. So there are many suggestions to interpret it as quantum phase, and I will talk about it. And then going to four-dimensional field, it resembles second gravity electromagnetics, getting second set of Maxwell equations, and this unifying vacuum dynamics of these three scales of energy is obtained here in this CAS model by just this Hamiltonian energy density. So this is electromagnetic Hamiltonian. Then to get to this uniaxial pneumatic, so it's called Faber model. So it's based on this model. We get this kind of Hamiltonian, and then this generalization I talk about, I focus on is going to this general. So we don't no longer rotate some vector, some abstract object, but some real three-dimensional object like ellipsoid, like the molecule in liquid crystal. And the potential should be a Higgs-like potential to prefer this vacuum, this dynamics of vacuum, which is non-trivial, like sphere or SO3 here. Okay, so I've mentioned this liquid crystal experiments, then they observe these quantized charges with also Coulomb-Planck interaction. So in this link there is very nice talk by Ivan Smaliuch, also reminding about this resemblance with particle physics. Okay, so from the other side, I've mentioned this problem with quantum effects. So, for example, double slit experiment with interference. So there are very nice. So from one side, the fluxons in a superconductor are because of vortex, are also called macroscopic quantum phenomena, and they are topological solitons like here. And they observe for them Kasher interference in double slit kind of. Then there is Max generator. Then there is tunneling. There is Aharonov bomb. And also in the last 15 years, there appeared many hydrodynamical systems with walking droplets being kind of wave particle duality object. And for example, they got this interference on two slits. So here are the blue lines and single trajectories, and then they averaging they get these interference patterns. So it is obtained by this corpuscle having coupled wave around it. It's called pilot wave. Also the corpuscle travels one path, but this coupled wave, pilot wave, travels all the paths and controls the trajectory of the corpuscle. So this is why I need this quantum phase, this additional degree of freedom beside electromagnetism. There is also this kind of quantum phase for this pilot wave. And ideally, it should be created by particles. So I need this clock kind of. I'll talk about it. They get many others also quantum-like phenomena for this classical wave particle duality object, like orbit quantization. It's very nice that the coupled wave with the corpuscle has to become standing wave. So we have quantized orbits because the coupled wave have to get resonance with the field. So getting a standing wave described by Schrödinger equation, also tunneling, also this quantum-like statistics, the Zeeman effect using Coriolis force in place of Lorentz force, also the double quantization, so not only of one quantum kind of quantum number, but of two, like n and l and momentum for atomic physics. So many experiments can be obtained this way. So we hopefully could get this kind of quantum effects for the objects in liquid crystals and yes, models of particles. Here is nice lecture by John Bush. I recommend looking at. Okay, so let's go to these topological defects. So I have shown here two-dimensional topological defects. So here is for vector fields. So that means that going through some loop around the field rotates plus one. That means 2π. Here is minus 2π. Here is also plus 2π. Here is 4π. But also, as mentioned, we can have 1/2 if using ellipsoids. So that means object that rotated after pi by pi, we get the same object. Minus 1/2. So this 1/2 suggests that maybe it resembles spin. Also, in superconductors, these flux are because of vortex, there are quants of magnetic fields. So this is another suggestion that maybe it is connected with spin, as spin is in particles is connected with magnetic dipole moment usually. Another suggestion that to interpret this kind of two-dimensional topological charge with a spin is that quantum rotation operator says that the rotating spin S particles by some theta angle rotates quantum phase by theta times spin. So this definition exactly agrees with this two-dimensional topological defect. So why two-dimensional topological defect seems similar with spin. For electric charge, we would need this three-dimensional topological defect, right? Like this hedgehog in three dimensions. So to get long-range interaction, so if you have two topological defects, plus to the topological charge and minus, in various distances, we can see that when they go close together, then the total tension of the field decreases, getting this long range interaction thanks to this non-trivial vacuum like unitary vectors. Then we have this kind of two-dimensional Gauss-Ampere law that integrating change over loop, you get total magnetic field through this loop, etc. Also, we will need this clock I've mentioned. So we would like that maybe electron doesn't have just a standing wave, but maybe it rotates all the time. So there are these nice experiments. So it's also called Zitterbewegung. There is one experiment under this link that they observe this. It's very fast. It's 10 to 21st hertz approximately clock, which should correspond to this pilot wave. wavelength of this wave is Compton wave wavelength. So these experiments. Oh, okay, I have to have it later. Okay, so the models I'm talk about is are close to so-called skirmish models, which are quite popular, also by Tennyson skirm. Also for particle models like nucleus especially. So here are some models of nuclei. So hydrogen, I don't know, deuteron, tritium. So they interpret topological charge not as electric charge as I've talked about, but as baryon number. So this is baryon number. So the kinetic energy is kind of similar to what I will use. I will also use this field of matrices, but a bit different kinetic energy. But the main difference is that they use potential energy such that there is only single minimum of this energy. So no longer Higgs-like, but with single minimum. That means that far from particle, from singularity, that the field should quickly go to this single minimum. So we should only expect short-range interaction. So for nuclear forces, it's nice, but there is no electromagnetism here. So no electromagnetism, so that means proton and neutron are the same. No, we know they aren't. No long-range interaction, only short-range. So in fact, the proton should be lighter than neutron, and in the model I talk, we also get baryons, and there is a suggestion why proton is lighter than neutron. So the difference is that we use non-trivial vacuum. That is no longer point vacuum, minimum of the potential, but sphere or SO3 vacuum. So dynamics of this vacuum, as mentioned, it should correspond to electromagnetism. So it's massless, it's called also Goldstone bosons. So using just this kind of Lagrangian, this is from Faber article, we should get this quantization of charge with this potential, we get regularization. This is Lorentz invariant model, so having Coulomb interaction, we also get entire electromagnetism. So this is repaired electromagnetism with quantized charge. Okay. So I would like to generalize it to this biaxial pneumatic case. Okay, so here is some sketch of what to do with further particles. So I've mentioned that the three hedgehogs resemble three leptons as the same charge, but different regularization, different mass. So also this magnetic dipole, so there are no naked charges, they have to have this magnetic dipole. Then we could have, for example, very short loop like this fluxon, but in vacuum. So we can have this fluxon. So in cross section it looks like that. So we have three types of such this kind of fluxons, vortices, vortex. So why they resemble neutrinos? Because they are extremely stable. To interact with it is very difficult to interact with it. Also, we could have oscillations kind of between. So we can, through internal rotation, we can get from one to another. So we could get oscillations. And then for more complex topological configurations as particles, that we can get simple knots. Yeah, so for example, so we have one type of vortex around second type of vortex. So they have to agree because this is the same field. So to make them agree, here is the lightest vortex in the center, and the second has to be different muon vortex, second type of vortex around. So to be made of the same field. And there appears interaction between them. So here is this vortex around, so this is cross section, vortex around, here is vortex around, and here is the vortex in the center of different type. So you can see that this vortex around enforces some curvature in this vortex inside. So this curvature corresponds to, this is symmetric, so circularly symmetric. So this vortex, this curvature corresponds to hedgehog. So this becomes part of charge. through this interaction you get partial charge in baryons. So proton can just enclose this partial charge to one charge plus E, but neutron has to compensate it. So there is some positive charge like quarks, and then neutron has to compensate it down to zero. So it needs a longer structure, and this elongation costs energy. So it suggests why proton is lighter than neutron. Naively, you'd think that it should be the opposite, because proton has charge and charge costs energy, like 5.11 keV in electron. So we should have the other, but surprisingly, a proton is lighter, and this is suggestion because baryons require charge, and so neutron has to compensate this required charge. Also for deuteron, we have two baryons, both require charge, but here they can share the one charge. So some positive charge here, some positive charge here, some negative in the middle, and it agrees with many properties of deuteron, like that deuteron has large electric quadrupole moment, so it's quite non-trivial, because proton and neutron shouldn't have naively quadrupole moment. But here we can see that yes, they should have this plus, plus and minus. So this is relatively large electric quadrupole moment. Also, the magnetic dipole moment is sum of magnetic dipole moments of the two baryons. And we can see that because the spins are aligned in the same direction. So there are nice agreement. There is nice agreement with nuclear physics regarding deuteron. And for a larger particle, larger nuclei, they can form knots, kind of knots, with this vortex. There are many ways to do it. This is a difficult question, how it exactly should look like. Also, there are so-called halo nuclei, halo neutrons. Maybe let me, oh, here are some halo nucleus, lithium 11. So we can see that there are two neutrons in very large distance, like 2.5 femtometers distance. So it seems that it's larger distance than the nuclear force, but still they are binded in a relatively stable way. So the question is how they are binded. And suggestion here is that there is some vortex going to these neutrons which allow to bind them. So this is a difficult question, how to get binding of these halo neutrons. Another quantum number is, for example, strangeness. So we could try to interpret it by twisting this loop around, and it would decay by releasing this twist. So that the mesons would correspond to such loop with the twist. So it's a very difficult question, because the number of baryons are in dozens of or hundreds so but also the number of the space of this kind of knots is very complex in topologically, so maybe there could be found correspondence, but this is very difficult work. Also, we could have this beta decay, which is very important, that neutron with plus in the center and minuses shifts the charge to one direction, then they split apart. There is an electron, and there is released large energy as such a bubble, which is neutrino. So it could be fit here, but sure, this is only a hypothesis. What are the details here? Okay, so here is some regularization from Faber's article. The red line is the energy density of electric field. It would go to infinity without this Higgs potential, but the green and blue line correspond to this Higgs potential, which allows to prevent this infinity of red line. If looking at charges in various distances, Faber got energy which agrees with Coulomb potential. However, there is some small deformation. So we can see that for very small distances, this charge potential is deformed. So it corresponds to it's called running coupling, that the alpha deforms for very, very high energies, that means very, very, very small distances. So, this finite size of a lepton, running coupling can be seen as such finite size effect. Also, so I've mentioned that the deuteron might look like a donut. So here would be the two donuts. So these are actual plots from article I'll show in a moment. Also suggesting that deuteron looks like there is some donut around some central. Okay, and also here are a few papers suggesting that maybe neutron is not just zero charge. We assume that it's made of three quarks, so there should be some charge distribution inside in neutron. And so some papers suggesting that neutron has positive core and negative shell. And this is exactly what is suggested here, that there is positive core of the neutron and negative shell around. So it's a nice agreement, very non-trivial facts from particle physics, which are directly suggested by this model. So maybe it's coincident, but maybe it's something deeper. Okay, so the problem, the most controversial thing here, I think, is that it requires possibility of these vortices, this abrikosov vortex, fluxon-like structures, not only in superconductor as we observe them, but in vacuum. So the question is if there could be this kind of structures, one-dimensional structures, magnetic structures in vacuum. And I think that the strongest suggestion is that in sun's corona, they observe these nearly one-dimensional structures, magnetic structures. They have energy density per length, like mass density. So this energy is released in so-called reconnection. So there is nice article here, and so they record magnetic flux tubes. And so the big question is why they are so stable, nearly one-dimensional structures. So here is a book about them, and they said this book also suggests that maybe there is something more fundamental about this stability of these one-dimensional structures. That maybe there is required some, for example, topological mechanism, as suggested here. Another argument that we need these fluxons might be this halon nuclei binding neutrons in relatively large distances. Also, there are some suggestions about behavior of positronium. Why? So then we have orton parapositronium, and then they have different of lifetimes in approximately 1,000. So one of them is very 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 stable. Okay. So I think the strongest argument here is this sun's corona, that they have these one-dimensional stable structures. Okay. So I've mentioned about the nuclear baryon. Agreement. So this suggestion that neutron is not just zero charge, but has this positive core and negative shell can be found in these three articles, for example. You can link on them. So all of them suggest that maybe neutron has positive core and negative charge. We get here just to explain automatically because looking at this interaction of these two vortices, there should be positive charge, which in neutron has to be compensated. What explains why proton is lighter and why we can have binding of deuteron to share one charge. And for deuteron, there are also this large electric quadruple moment, which is quite surprising how to get quadruple moment for proton plus neutron, and also that it has aligned spins, the two baryons, and there are papers suggesting that deuteron did have this kind of loop around, kind of. So there are some resemblance with results of experimental physics, but there are very difficult questions to get the details. Okay, so let's go to mathematics. So I've mentioned that this is regularization. And in vacuum, that means far from particles, you would like to get electromagnetism. So in vacuum, we can assume that the length of the vector is just one. So now there is the trick to how to get this curvature. So to get the curvature of this field of unitary vectors in vacuum, so we define this connection, affine connection, which says going in given direction I, what is local rotation of the field. So it defines local rotation while going in transporting in I direction. So here, for example, the local rotation goes with one over distance from the hedgehog. And now we need the second power. We take curvature to count the topological charge. So for curvature, we define the product of these two connections. So for example, for hedgehog, it's one over r squared, like in electric field. So defining this curvature as electric field, we will get with Gauss law, we will calculate the topological charge, because looking at this Jacobian from some closed surface to this sphere S2, the Jacobian is the determinant, and which can be written this way. So integrating this determinant over this closed surface, we should get this winding number, how many times we are winding around this sphere, and interpreting it as electric field, we get in Gauss law, we get topological charge. So we get charge quantization. Okay, this is electric field, but we also need magnetic fields, and for Lorentz invariant, we defined this way. Faber defines he uses this F tensor, the electromagnetic F tensor, but for the curvatures, with star, that means dual F tensor, that means we replace positions of electric and magnetic field. So originally here should be magnetic fields and here should be electric fields. So in dual we define the opposite. So that spatial curvature means electric field, and space-time curvature means magnetic field. So for magnetic field we need some dynamics, there is some rotations in space and rotation in time. So there is a lot of dynamics in this model hidden, in fact. Okay, also there is this finite size effect I've mentioned, that taking such two configurations, here there are opposite charges, so electron positron, so here is plus, here is minus, the opposite, and looking at energy of such field configuration, Faber got this Coulomb-like dependence with deformation. This deformation is called Rayleigh coupling in particle physics, that this alpha in Coulomb law is deformed for various interactions. So that we should have some finite size effect, and they are here obtained. Okay, so electron is very complex object. So it's not only a charge, it's also a magnetic dipole, so there is also magnetic field involved. Also there is kind of gyroscope, so gyroscope means that attaching force in one direction, there is response in other direction. So if attaching here, this is spin, this is here, attaching force here, the field is this gyroscope, responses here, for example, leading to this Larmor precession, that we have this constant force and it leads to some constant frequency precession. And also we have this de Broglie clock I've mentioned, approximately 10 to 21st hertz, so it's extremely fast. And here is this article, the best confirmation, but there are also confirmations in solid state, of Titter Bewegung, because from Dirac equation you can conclude Titter Bewegung, and they can recreate Dirac equation in solid state systems. So here is directly using electrons. So the idea is to use very fast electrons. So using ATMF electrons, the distance between the ticks of this clock would become in agreement with the lattice of silicon crystal. So getting the agreement of this distance between these two ticks of the clock with the lattice constant, they get absorption. So we can see that there is increased absorption here if there is kind of resonance between this clock and the lattice structure, and they cannot explain it differently. So it seems good confirmation for this electron's clock. We need to recreate it in the model of particle, and it's difficult. So for Hedgehog, getting many of these asymmetry, this I think that they all three look related. The dipole, the Larmor, and the clock. So it's not exactly spinning, but there is topological defect and spinning. It looks like that. So using this Bayesian nematic, we get this asymmetry, this part at least of this required effects. And we need the clock. I mentioned about the clock later. So having the clock, we get this evolution of this pilot wave around, so to get the quantum-like effects. So here is more math. So the question is how to generalize this from unitary vector field, director field, in Faber model to general rotation of the general object, like this ellipsoid molecules in Bayesian nematic. So we would like to generalize this unitary vector field. The first attempt is to use orthogonal field of orthogonal matrices instead of these unitary vector fields. So we can again get connection, which is no longer a vector, but it's an antisymmetric matrix. And we can look at this matrix. So knowing it is antisymmetric, you can denote its coordinates, forming kind of two vectors. So one is spatial rotation and one is temporal rotation. So denoting these six coordinates with two vectors. So one is the spatial rotation with electromagnetic vector, and this temporal, as mentioned before, nicely agrees, looks like this gravity electromagnetic effect. So toward gravity for second set of Maxwell equation for gravity. So it corresponds to tiny tilts of this longer time axis kind of. So denoting this gamma antisymmetric matrix this way with these two vectors. Now we have we previously wanted to denote the curvature, spatial curvature as electric field. So here we have more curvatures. We have spatial curvature, but we have also this kind of gem curvature, gravitational curvature, and also this curvature between them. So we have electromagnetic gem interaction. So this is for second set of Maxwell equations for gravity, and here is for interaction. So interaction, for example, we can see in light bending by sun. So there should be some electromagnetic gem interaction, but the details are yet to be found. So wanting to denote this F mini, dual F mini, as tensor, as commutator, we get this kind of behavior that kind of space. We have this electromagnetism plus curvature of the space, kind of. So in this picture, space time can be flat, but we have only curvature of space as this hyper manifold perpendicular to this zeroth axis. So we could try to do something like general relativity here, but with this difference that space time is flat and only space is curved. So there is a suggestion how to do it, and we get two sets of Maxwell equations, but the details are yet to be found, like how the mass also becomes the gravitational mass. So it's yet to be found. However, in flat space-time, this commutator will vanish. So we could conclude here that this gravitational curvature implies spatial curvature, so like for time dilation for this slight bending, but it's insufficient. It's nice warm up, but something more complex. So we need some object to rotate, not just rotation field of rotation matrix, but also some object to rotate these ellipsoids. Okay, and now we do it. So we no longer want to use this O field of just rotations, but of some object, rotating object, some ellipsoid. Yeah, so here is our field. So rotated. So this is the shape of our ellipsoid. If it has this diagonal matrix with which is preferring some shape of ellipsoid, like three legs of axis. In three dimension, in four dimension also zeroed, but we don't go further in this moment towards four dimensions. We have some potential which prefers some shape of this ellipsoid. So it would like to be some fixed. I call it capital lambdas. Small lambdas are the current, these lengths. So the heat like prefers them to be fixed, but allows to get to like maybe let's go back here for a moment, like here that in the center of the ellipse field it can go to circular to if two axes become equal, then this is the same. So it allows to regularize energy of singularity to finite energy. Okay, so it is crucial, this regularization, and the mass mostly comes from this regularization. okay, so we get these charges as I've shown. So it's plus topological charge, and this is kind of minus. So this would be anti-leptons, hopefully. So the difference is that here the rotation is the same, and here is the opposite. And we can see that it rotates in opposite direction. So we can kind of leptons and anti-leptons. And then to define this tensor, which we would like to use in place of this F mini tensor, F magnetic tensor. So natural guess, maybe it's guess, is to use this commutator of the derivatives of M field, of this M original M field, toward two directions. So instead of curvature, we directly define this F tensor, F magnetic tensor, which now is a matrix, no longer an anti-symmetric matrix, so no longer a single value, but now we have matrix of these anti-symmetric matrices. So let's postulate this kind of in place of curvature, and if you look at vacuum dynamics, indeed is constructed by curvature. So again, it's integrating it over a closed surface, which should get topological charge times some constants. So we should get the charge quantization still, but with different energies for various types of curvature. So it's a bit more complex. So it's yet to be understood well. So we get generalization of this Fabre's model to some general field of some rotated object, not just vectors, needle-like vectors, but some concrete three-dimensional objects like ellipsoids. Okay, and so we use Lagrangian as electromagnetic Lagrangian. So we use this F mini tensor defined as previously, and minus the potential. The potential, unfortunately, is still to be found. So the bigger question is finding the details of the potential now for now. And so wanting to work on the original this commutator, it's not very convenient. So let us define this A field in analogy to electromagnetic for potential. So if you define A field in this way, then using this as in electromagnetic this kind of formulation for this F field F tensor, then it agrees. So derivating here the second derivative is we can change second derivative order of second in second derivative, so in flat space time at least you can use this formula. This A for potential becomes in vacuum, so again far from the particle, it becomes like this. So we can see that it's kind of resemble the in Faber it was just the gamma, just the connection, just the local rotation, and here they are weighted. So the local rotations are weighted with this shape. So this difference of length of this the three axis of two of the three axes. So in Faber. And then the gamma was nearly the same, the connection was nearly the same as A field, and here it's multiplied by the shape. So we get shape dependence comparing to just vector field in Faber model. And also he uses curvature directly, and here it's again multiplied by the shape, by this lambdas. Define the shape of these molecules, let's say ellipsoids. So we get this kind of A field, and let's check that going back to Faber's model to these vectors, we should get the same. So for uniaxial pneumatic, so we would like to say that the second and third axis is the same, is zero. And first axis, let's say, has length like one. So for this case, we can use just this matrix as product. So this is matrix with projection on this n direction. So substituting to this formula, we get indeed the same as in Faber. So again, this A becomes just the connection. So we can see that this is generalization of the connection. To include the shape of the object we are rotating. Okay, so it is a nice picture to see this generalize this biaxial pneumatic as a small perturbation of uniaxial pneumatic. So if slowly increasing this second lambda 2 from zero to some small positive, let's say, number, hopefully, then doing it by perturbation can allow us to better understand the situation. So I think it's a promising direction. Maybe also to find the potential by trying to consider the perturbation of lambda 2. Okay, so and finally, using this F mini, we have this variation, and then we can find the Euler-Lagrange equations, which become Maxwell's equations. So we have F and F tensor. In fact, we can substitute as the electric and magnetic fields. A for potential is this the Lambertian. Is this another so it looks like Maxwell equations. The question is how to choose the potential, and it's a difficult question. I mentioned in the moment, but then it looks like the maximum equation. However, we need to remember that all of them are not just values, but matrices. So all are real anti-symmetric matrices, 3x3, or maybe 4x4, if including gravity. We have also these terms which should vanish to this integration by parts. Okay, so the question is how to choose the potential. So to get similarity with electromagnetics, we would like to work on the A field. So I've mentioned at the beginning to use this kind of potential, Higgs-like potential, which prefers some shape of ellipsoids. However, here is a suggestion to use potential from A. So A is this kind of formula. So A has also derivative dependence. So if using Higgs-like potential for A, then we are also enforcing some speed. So it's kind of promising to try to use Higgs-like potential, but not for A, but not from A, M, but from A. So using that, Higgs-like potential would enforce some velocity, local velocity, which speed is dependent on the direction of rotation, so it could give us the clock. So working on electromagnetics on this A field, we assume here that there is more fundamental M field, which actually we described, which gives this charge quantization, but we directly work on this A field, enforcing some speed of this underlying M field. So there is some I think hope for clock from using, especially using potential from A. And we get standard Hamiltonian as in electromagnetics. Again, this part should vanish. So okay, so this is the last slide. So as a summary, we have the standard model, which is 19 plus 7 parameters and maybe some additional. So we have at least 26 parameters now with this huge Lagrange with hundreds of terms. So it looks maybe also there is this problem with gravity. There is still it's non-renormalizable gravity. So there are lots of infinities in quantum field theories like standard model, and this infinity is too large to regularize them with standard subtraction of infinity. So there are still problems, even though this is huge model with huge number of parameters and a huge formula, hundreds of terms. So maybe we could try to see this huge formula Lagrangian as some expansion, like Taylor expansion of some deeper theory. So the question is where to look for such deeper theory for which this would be effective description given by this huge formula. So the suggestion is maybe that liquid crystals, which are available in physics, we can observe this charge quantization Coulomb-Planck interaction inside liquid crystals. So exploring this suggestion, as I've talked, there is a suggestion to use this relatively simple Hamiltonian. This is practically generalization of electromagnetic Hamiltonian, using maybe also getting the clock as mentioned, and this Hamiltonian gives us not only electromagnetics but also kind of quantum phase, also with wave equation, as in quantum mechanics, as for these rotations of twists of this axis, so much lower energetic degree of freedom. And also, going to 4x4 matrices, we also get second set of Maxwell equations, so we get automatically generalization, unification with gravity electromagnetics, so this is not exactly Einstein's general relativity. So the big question is to explore these similarities. And this simpler Hamiltonian, much simpler than this huge standard model, already has charge quantization and regularization, which are missing from standard electromagnetics, and this is just reparation of standard electromagnetics to bring back these two crucial features. Each already also has three types of charges, like the leptons, with the same charge but different mass, with magnetic dipole, so there is this asymmetry for spin, automatically from this Heibull theorem. Like the three neutrinos, which are very stable, which can oscillate between each other, which could be created in beta decay, as we know from physics. Then there are also baryons, also T-families, so there is a suggestion why three, because we live in three-dimensional space, with neutrons heavier than protons, with deuteron with binding energy for deuteron, explaining why deuteron has quadruple moment, why the magnetic dipole is not the same as sum of magnetic dipoles. Also, then we can have large families of knots for both for more complex baryons. There are lots of ways like this twisting for strangers and so on. Also for halonuclei neutrons binded in large distance, so it should be 2.3 femtometers. It's too large here. So there is very large number of surprising agreements for super simple model, just this one, if we get the potential right. So maybe it's more than just a coincidence. So and finally, having such topological defects, to consider scattering, we should consider Feynman ensemble of possible scenarios behind the given situation. So we need some perturbative QFT, and hopefully this perturbative QFT would be described by the close to standard model Lagrangian. Okay, thank you.